I mean, it's not as it's a small community. It's a small community in Los Angeles too. Everyone thinks it's such a massive, massive industry, but it's a pretty small community in both cities. But especially here to for Vancouver, it was very rare to be able to come back so early after the first time you do an episode of a show, and then come back, you know, a few seasons later as a completely different character. It was really a rare thing to be able to do, and I was glad I was able to do it. And it was a fun thing to do.
And we talk about two completely different characters, and dare I say, that's not an underestimatement. They were two very different contrasting characters. One was a Jaffa from an alien world, and then one was a rogue sort of militant sort of unit. And I imagine you sort of took pride in both characters in terms of there wasn't, did I'd imagine there was no leniency of favoritism towards one or the other, given that they were so different and they were so unique that you couldn't really compare or contrast them both.
Yes, it's important as an actor not to judge your character. It's best to just look at them as people and try and just tell the truth, them being who they are in the situation, and you let the plot points and the drama of the show carry them through, and then you get to see who they are. But yes, the first character, the Jaffa character, yeah, he wasn't the best guy in the world. Both characters had their issues. But I would say he was kind of the weaker of the two. He had a situation going on with his wife, and she was a former lover of Teal'c, the character played by Christopher Judge. So there was all that going on. And then in the later episode I did with Hoskins, yeah, he was just an all-out bad guy. He just was selfish, was willing to kill his own grandmother to get what he needed. So yeah, two different guys, both with issues, but one definitely more aggressive than the other. Yeah, yeah. And that's what made it fun to have that dichotomy between the two.
And that first character, Frotac, he's a bit misunderstood in terms of the story plotline, because when Colonel Jack O'Neill is confronted with him and the situation that he's going to turn out his back, he is unaware at the time that Frotac has seen Teal'c betray him, in terms of his wife betrayed him, the love of his life,
yes,
betrayed him with Teal'c, and he has gone through that. But yes, Colonel Jack O'Neill is unaware of that circumstances. He just thinks he's out for no good. He is unaware of what went down or the sort of situation, and nobody knows that Frotac has seen what he has seen in terms of that. So it almost takes that secret to his grave, dare I say.
Absolutely, absolutely. So yeah, there was a little bit of redemption there for him at the end. Yeah, there was a transition, and yeah, so that was, it was actually a well-written, boy, you're very well informed on your episodes there. there was that issue so it was a fun part to play for sure. It was early in my career. I ended up learning a great deal from doing that, that episode as Frotac, for sure.
Yeah. And when you got the call to come back the second time, and obviously the first episode, we see you with that bit of black hair in terms of, the Frotac, and this time you come back, You're older, you have a clean shaved head on you, you're playing this Hoskins character. There's almost sense of a Jack Bourne to him in terms of he's on the sort of this agent with a mission. There's almost like a bit of a KGB sort of feel to him in terms of he's militant, he's defiant, he's almost bordering on the line of terrorism, really, in terms of being a terrorist.
Absolutely. He really, really was single-mindedly focused on getting what he needed, and whatever he had to do it, he would do. Peter DeLuise was the director of that episode, and it was interesting working with him, because he's he's known here in Vancouver mostly for a lot of comedy. He's I've worked with him on another show called Level Up. It was more of a sort of a kids show, but it was comedy based, and he does a lot of comedy. And on Stargate, he handled that situation very well with all the drama and action pieces that were associated with that whole world in Stargate. So working with him was a great treat. And he just kept coming up to me and whispering in my ear as Hoskins, ice, ice. In other words, ice cold, no remorse, get the job done, and don't have any feelings about it. And so great direction from a guy who's known for comedy, but he can do both. And it was that was a great experience.
Yeah. And I imagine when you appeared on season two, a fresh, energetic, sort of young cast in terms of Stargate SG1, not knowing their sort of journey, whether to have 3 seasons, 4 seasons, in terms of that, all up in the air in terms of TV ratings, trying to make their mark, trying to make their show a success. When you came back, obviously, 6 seasons, 6 years later, and obviously most of the main casting had probably over 100 episodes done at that sort of stage in terms of that, did you almost still feel that energy? Did you all feel that buzz, or did you feel a cast that maybe was maybe tired, a bit waned in terms of having gone through a rigorous sort of a schedule in terms of the six seasons? Did you still get that sort of sense of drive, that sense of giddiness, that sense of excitement when you were there in season two?
Yeah, that's a very, very good question. Excellent question. Yeah, coming back the second time, it was just a well-oiled machine. You know, it was like a deeper pathway had been formed. And so, excuse me just a moment. I'm going to give our sound a little bit of a break here. I'm just going to close a window so that you can hear me a little better. My sincerest apologies.
It's no problem. It's perfect. I'm enjoying the family pictures.
Thank you so much for your patience. Yeah. It's summer here in Vancouver, and it's extremely warm, well above seasonal temperatures. They're breaking records here for the heat. Coming back, it wasn't a weariness. It was just, we know what we're doing, and they just got through it, and it was very fast. I remember they were getting everything they needed, and it was still very professional and quality, had a high quality to it. But they it was just, like I said, a well-oiled machine. So they were getting through it really well. All the action sequences, all the stunt sequences, it just flowed. And so it didn't feel bogged down. I felt the energy was there. And again, I got to mention Peter DeLuise. He's a very energetic guy, and it kind of starts with the lead of the show and the director. They can kind of set the tone for things, and him being so well prepared and having such a good high energy, a childlike fascination still with what he's doing, that really added a great energy to it. So I don't know, it might have been different with different directors on different episodes, but for that one I worked on, at that point Stargate was just a well-oiled machine, and they were just working together. They barely had to like say anything in terms of setting up lighting and whatnot. It was just almost sign language. Wonderful to see.
And when you come back the second time as a Hoskins character, you got to work with some sort of cool gadgets on sort of set in terms of what their sort of effects was like, and in terms of what the props and the instruments you were given, and in terms of projection, where you're almost asking yourself like a giddy teenage boy, oh, what does this do? What does this do? What's this sort of effect?
Absolutely. As Hoskins, I don't know if you remember, but I had the rare occasion to be using a weapon, a handgun, that was rapid fire. So you just pull the trigger once, and it's just a flurry of a fuselage of bullets coming out. And I remember that being a lot of fun. I just felt like a kid again, because usually when you have those multi-magazine weapons where you can fire a lot in a short period of time, it's a rifle or AK kind of AK-47 kind of thing. I'm not a fan of guns myself in real life, but in play acting, it's very exhilarating. So to have that power in a handgun, I just pull the trigger once and it's just, it was incredible. The special effects were awesome. I had to do a little bit of fighting. Me and Michael Shanks kind of got into it at a certain point. It's I love what I do, especially in that episode. It really brought out the kid in me, and I think all of us.
Yeah. And Peter, I know it's a busy time for you. You have a movie just out here in Ireland in our cinemas at the moment coming out, Long Legs, where you play a senior FBI agent alongside a Nicolas Cage movie. You might enlighten our audience a bit about that and other projects where we might see Peter Bryant in our TV screens or movie screens for the remainder of 2024.
Of course. I did Long Legs the February before last. It was a very interesting shoot. I was on for, they were able to accomplish most of my stuff in a couple of days. I had one scene with Nicolas Cage where I'm interrogating him. And I gotta say, it was exhilarating to watch him work. I can't say too much about the film, of course. But to see an actor of that caliber right there doing his thing was just an incredible experience. On one level, I was blown away, but then on another level, I was, oh, well, he's an actor. Like it's at a certain point, and all throughout my career, I've worked with some pretty well-known people, and I've had very lucky to have been able to do that. And at a certain point, when you're just working with them on the set, they're just actors, just like you, and you're rehearsing the lines, you're running it, and it's not really until later when you're driving home and you go, "Oh my God, I was just working with Nicolas Cage or Jack Lemmon or whoever." There was a professional quality to it that kept it grounded, so I wasn't freaking out being on a set with him. That's going to be a very creepy movie, very scary. It's a scary one, a Long Legs. Also, there's a television series called Family Law that airs on the CW in the United States, global here in Canada. It's a legal show, and I play a lawyer who's always going up against Victor Garber's character. He's the second lead on the show. Jewel State plays the lead, plays his daughter on the show, and I play his friend. We golf together. We go and play tennis together, but we butt heads in the courtroom. So it's a wonderful dichotomy and a great cast and a great bunch of people. And I think we just finished season four, but I think season three will be airing soon. And that's what I've got going on right now. And a couple of other things, a couple of irons in the fire too coming up that I can't really discuss, but yeah. Those two things are what's coming up soon.
And Peter, to final question to leave you now, and a question we finish with all our guests throughout the show, 60 episodes, you've all got this question to finish. So we're going to the same question to you now. Let's pretend there was a Stargate sci-fi encyclopedia as such, and they put all the characters into the encyclopedia. And we'll just take Hoskins, for example, and they put the character Hoskins into the encyclopedia. They left us two blank sentences under his name on almost like a synopsis as such, not really an epitaph, but a description. And they asked you, Peter Bryant, having played the character Hoskins in Stargate SG1, to write those two sentences. What would you like those two sentences to read?
Three sentences about Hoskins?
Two sentences, yes.
Two sentences about Hoskins.
Yeah. If you met Hoskins across the street and you were where someone tells me, do you know that guy? What's he like? What would you like the two sentences to sum him up?
Oh boy. I always get the job done. Oh, it's tough because he was just supposed Hoskins. The job is everything. No remorse. That's all I got. That's all.